A very good afternoon and welcome to the program. This is the Touchline on Y254. My name is Maxwell Wasik. Of course, fading out there is about highlights between Deontay Wilder alongside Tyson Fury that ended in level a draw, and probably there is a rematch, and the win of that particular outcome will face Anthony Joshua, the 27-year-old English international, who's been looking forward to play either of the two, saying that he's ready and he can even beat both of them. But right about now, we're going to review 2018 Kodbiro tournament, one of the successful off-season tournaments happening in Nairobi, 40th edition that is currently underway, group stage almost coming to an end, and I'm hosting guys who've been actively involved in terms of organization of the same. Robert Ochola, CEO. Bro, what's up, man? Good to have you, man. How have you been? Long time.
I've been good.
The last time you were on the show is, I think, last year, when you were talking about it.
Yeah, when we were celebrating the 39th edition. But a good thing now, God has kept us alive. Despite Deontay Wilder's wild punches, still alive, and it's all good.
You watched the bout, probably. Where was your money?
My money was with Deontay Wilder.
But objectively, without any bias, impartiality, who won?
Tyson Fury. Without a doubt.
Sportsmanship. Hassan Abdul from Experience FC. Why do you call your team Experience FC, Hassan?
Because we play football for a while.
Just audibility.
Yeah.
Audible. Why do you call your team Experience FC?
Because we play football for more than 10 years in a tournament. So that we call ourselves Experience.
So it consists of most veterans, right?
Yeah.
Then Frederick Amolo, coach, Pelico FC. How is the team doing right now? Now getting into the culmination of the group stage. Are you hopeful? You guys gonna win?
Yeah, we are hopeful. The team is doing good. And so far we played three matches. We've won two and drawn one.
Yeah. Wow. Excellent performance. Robert, now greatest partnership. You guys, I'm reliably informed, you're gonna be working in partnership with Dondo Cup from TZ. What's the partnership all about? What does it entail?
But the Ndondo Cup is a Tanzanian version of Kodbiro.
Sure.
Yeah, sure, very sure. It's if you look at the hype, if you look at the objectives of both tournaments, we are into developing football, you know, not only for as a sport, but for careers and also for economic development for all the participants. And Ndondo Cup has been in existence for a couple of years, though Kodbiro is a bigger brother. And we're celebrating our 40th anniversary, by the way. And we found it as part of our long-term objectives to go regional. And Dondo Cup is an equal partner in all this. So we're going to start Dondo Cup. Kodbiro, the winners in every edition, are going to be meeting in January to play now for a regional championship. So it's going to be very, very exciting. Trust me, the passion, the football passion that is in Tanzania, it's incredible. And when these guys come to Kenya, probably they're going to whitewash our streets. But in terms of football, the quality that is there at Ndondo Cup is at, I can say it's at par with what we have at Kodbiro. So I can credibly say we are going into this as two very able, credible partners who want the best out of African football.
People have been asking themselves this question. What's the secret behind the blistering show of Kodbiro tournament in terms of attendance? The crowds have been quite mouth-watering. I'm a journalist, but I remember attending some of your matches, but almost, you know, getting denied entry because it's almost full. What has been the secret compared to Kenyan Premier League, which are yet to attract such crowds?
To be very honest, I can say, number one, it's the fans themselves, the passion there for the game, and then also the teams. If you look at today, we have Okoth here. If he tells you the history of his club, Pelico, you'll be amazed. And you know where the footballers come from. You know, these teams are community-based teams. And when they come to the ground, they come with their families, they come with their friends. They're buoyed by the need of their community to win, to be champions in the tournament. And mind you, not only being the champions, but also just participating. I look at a team called Kimbo. Ruiru Kimbo. They became third in their group, so they're not qualifying the round of 16. And if you look at their comments, even if you go to the social media pages, they're saying that they came, they played, they're proud, they have left, but the third position. It's not easy at Cote Biro. So you see, we also follow on that, and we tell them, hey, next year you can come. Another reason why people love Cote Biro so much is the credibility of the tournament. You come in as either team, any team can come in and win it. And we don't favor, we are not, yes, there are issues of Timi Ofisi. Probably by the time we get out of here, they'll be saying Pelico or experience in Timi Ofisi. But the secret lies with the organization, the secret lies with the communities, the secret lies with the teams. And then the openness that we have, the honesty, the aura that we bring into the whole discourse. That's what makes Cote Biro to be great. And also the history, you know, it has a rich history. A tournament to be in existence for 40 years. Even FKF has not been in existence for 40 years. Remember, it was KFF. The name changes continuously. KPL was
this Super one has League. Remained Cote Biro, despite, you know, advocates and push for you to rename and change the name.
We've been told consistently, please change that name. That name is not corporate enough. You know, and we're asking, so which name is corporate? Are we looking for a corporate name, or are we looking for an identity that will resonate with the people? And Cote Biro resonates with the people. That's why we said we're not going to touch the name.
But what's the meaning of Cote Biro?
Cote Biro basically, it's a Luo name that means rain is coming. It has traditionally been played around this time when we have short rains. So when it starts in November, people are saying Cote Biro, the rain is coming. And though we are going to have many changes, but still, in fact, even the timing of the tournament is going to change, but the name is going to remain Cote Biro.
Hassan, you've defied all odds playing at this particular age. You will rarely find a player of your age, you know, a person of your age playing football right now. Do you do it for fun or passion? And how did it go during your heydays as far as professional football is concerned? You tried getting to another level, then if things fused, what do you attribute the same to?
Yeah, it's passion for me to play football because I play since at the age of 8. Now I'm turning 24 years. So I'm still going strong, and I want to be on another level, maybe playing Arsenal or Barcelona one time.
What has the tournament, the impact it's had on the community, especially the veteran players, those who've played football before, but now they are doing it for fun and passion as well, and entertainment overall?
You know, when you're a veteran, it's another passion for you, but when you're still young, it's another step for you to make in a Premier League, maybe nationwide. Because Cote Biro is the biggest tournament in Eastern Central Africa. Since I know Cote Biro since 2008 up to now, the players have seen very different talent. Some of them play Europe, because last time I have seen them. So, Musa Mohamed,
the one who plays for the national team around the stars, and former Gourmet defender.
I've seen Shakava playing for South B. So
South B All-Stars?
Yeah. Even
I've got a problem with Roba. I don't know why a team from Langata is not taking part. My hood, I think we're gonna quarrel over the same. But before we do, Frederick, you are a coach and you've mentored several players now who've played even at the national level. Edwin Lavats, I remember him playing for Gor, winning the league with them, playing for Harambee Stars as well. How has it been for you? The journey, the challenges?
The journey has been good. But with challenges, like what I normally do, I do dealing with the young players, youth. I go try and look for talent down there at the primary school level. I try and nurture them. When they reach class 8, I try and take them to secondary school, more so Jamhuri High School, where Robo used to be, and I used to be at
Jamhuri
High School, yeah. And you know Jamu, what it is, yeah? Boys with like fighting and all that. So I like dealing with the boys, and the boys enjoy themselves. I take them to tournaments, more so the Cote Biro. I do make sure that each and every year they participate, irrespective of the position they will be in. I like that. And we've churned out so many players like Edwin Lavasta, Arnold Origi.
Sure.
Yeah. There is a boy called Edward Mambo. They are currently playing in either in NSL or Premier League. Yeah.
So continuity has been the main concern, and people ask themselves, you know, these players who get spotted at the Cote Biro tournament, after a while they just vanish. How does it go? Where do they go?
Okay, some of our players, I might say that when they reach up there, they relax. Their aim is to play in KPL or NSL, but they don't want to further their career to go and play outside there. So once they reach up there, they see they've got money. They indulge themselves into so many things like drinking and all that. That's where they disappear to.
Robaziwani Grounds, I'm reliably informed, is still the venue, right?
Yes, it is.
And in terms of ensuring that players who take part during these off-season tournaments, I remember there was also this concern of, you know, KPL players should not be eligible to play for their respective clubs. It should be a tournament meant for, you know, Vijana wa Mtaa. How did it go?
When the season is over, you know, when we are all, when we're in off season,
yes,
all the players become Vijana wa Mtaa. Because now you're not representing your
club.
Now you're representing your community.
Yes,
where you grew up, where you came from, or whichever team you feel more attracted to. Yeah, and having KPL players in the tournament gives it an oomph, because we are giving young upcoming footballers an opportunity to play with or against the top professionals. I mean, if you want to be the best, then compete with the best. If you want to be the world champion in boxing, you can't come and fight against me. You go and fight against Tyson Fury, and then you go to Anthony Joshua. You know, so having people like, you remember a team that coach came with, Pelico?
Yes.
These were young guys just who had cleared Form 4. And they came and on their path to glory, they defeated Opitos.
Yes, Opitos, I remember Opitos.
Opitos is one of the most consistent teams in Cote Biro. They have all the stars, but they were beaten. They beat Pumwani. Pumwani had Jamal Mohamed in its rank. They had so many top players. I mean, for a team like that to win, it was awesome. So Cote Biro gives that opportunity, but then nobody recognizes a name in Cote Biro. People come to play as they are. Whichever team you belong to, whichever, even if you're coming from abroad, they don't care about that. They're coming to play against you, even if you're the best, and they're going to beat you. And I remember when, before Victor Mugabe flew out, the day before, he scored a very, very beautiful goal for Nyoi.
Nyoi FC.
Yeah.
Nyoi FC, I remember they played 1,000 seats,
yes,
at some time in the final.
In the finals, and they lost. But at that time, it was Mugabe who scored that goal. He's mentioned Origi. Origi is one of our sponsors. He sponsors the Goalkeeper of the Year Award, and he's also our international ambassador. He played for Pelico, same tournament, Oliech. Mention any player, even the current top crop, Akina Mieno, they play Cote Biro. But who wins? Any team can come.
Patrick Oboy as well?
Yeah, any team can come in and win the tournament. So as much as we have the big names, there, when you come to the field, your name remains your name. There are people who want that name. And that gives them a more motivation, more oomph, and more zeal to play and win. Because if you want to have glory, then go for it. Play against the best or play with the best. They'll make you shine. And from there, you'll be scouted. Right now, we have a young kid, Hamada. He's called Hamida or Hamada Abdulatif from South Sea. He's barely 15 years old. And he's a goalkeeper there. He's stopping shots there from all quarters.
So most likely going to get spotted by one of the KPL clubs?
Yeah, in fact, we've already informed.
Received interest.
Yeah, we've already informed also Origi about him. And trust me, by the end of the tournament, the boy is going to get not only glory, but a lot of recognition. That boy has a...
Much potential.
Yeah, and a bright future ahead of him. Because if he can stop a shot from Brigadier Sania, trust me, he has potential.
Brigadier, which position do you play for Experience FC? And those words from Robert here are gonna work probably in your favor, because he's saying that it doesn't matter the name you have, how you've established yourself in a community. Once you meet, it's about the capability on the pitch. So going forward, what are the prospects of your team performing better and, you know, if possible, win the championship, overall title?
You don't think about the Cote Biro, you don't care about the name. It's all about the ground. Depend on 90 minutes. You can be the world champion, but depend on how do you play that time. So 90 minutes will decide who will be the winner.
So what are the chances of your team Experience FC to perform?
90%.
90%?
Yeah.
That you're going to win the title. How did you fare during the last edition?
Last edition, we didn't expect the tournament.
Coach, so far, I know so good, the progress must be very encouraging, but what do you make of the potentiality of those who are taking part, the kids? I know it's a competition that brings together squads blended with youth and experience. What do you make of the same?
Okay, what there is now, with this tournament this year, we don't have Premier League players, not so many, because right now the KPL is just starting and the NSL started the other day. So the players, the young boys, they enjoy themselves very much. They want to lift the trophy. Eh? If you look, boys from other teams, be it Pelico, be it Umemebiz, Nyoi, they enjoy themselves. Yeah? So they want to shine. They're saying without the Premier League players, we can do it. Yeah.
So it's been more of enjoyment and professionally. Are we looking forward to see Kodbiro producing? Robert has already mentioned about several players who've, you know, participated in the competition and they are playing overseas. But now, during this current generation, are we looking forward to seeing the tournament producing a player probably to feature overseas?
So many.
So many.
So many. Believe you me, so many. The talent which is down there, it's awesome. Robert can attest to that. He can attest to that. So many players.
And of course, someone is asking me from our gallery, I think one of the technicians that he attended the tournament last year and maybe realized some sort of, you know, politicians try crowding the podium and, you know, sports has to be kept away from politics. I don't know. That is his angle, though. Going forward, can we put some sort of demarcation between this tournament and politics?
True, but this is Kenya. But before I answer that,
yes.
Just last week on Tuesday, we had a top football scout who came in from Brussels, from Belgium.
Yes.
He had come into Kenya for another mission, but he was told about Kodbiro. I invited him, we went to watch a match with him. It was just an impromptu. But the guy was taking so many videos. He was astonished. He said that he's going to make Kodbiro a priority event to come and look for players there. Because what he saw, he had to leave the same night, but what he saw there,
he didn't expect that.
Yeah, he didn't expect it. It was amazing. And those were, you were very young players. And this season, we're going to have potential, we're going to have a scout from Basel, from, you know, Basel.
Wow, Switzerland.
Yeah, from Switzerland. Yeah, the guy is going to be here at the finals. He just wants to come and look at what we have then, see the potential of it. So Kodbiro is being noticed, you know, even internationally. When you mention about politicians, where there's a crowd, there'll always be a politician somewhere there. And even with the Harambe Stars, see, it's, the politicians... And
during
are the ones,
their game against Black Stars of Ghana at Kasarani.
Yeah, they're the ones who push people to attend and all that. But with Kodbiro, it's the opposite. People come, then politicians come in. But what matters to us is how do we treat our fans and the politicians? We treat them as equals. As much as we have a podium, which is usually for our corporate sponsors, they come in and we welcome them because they're our leaders. But we don't give them an opportunity to make speeches. We just give them, because we have so many awards, we just tell them, you and you are going to give out awards. And then we are not sponsored by politicians.
Yes.
We look for corporate sponsorship. That gives us an edge in that we are not tied to anyone.
Or and you're not compromised.
We do not compromise. We are not going to bend into the whims of anyone. But, you know, Kenya, the way politics is intertwined with our lives, it's...
We can't run away from it.
Like the ground is supposed to be rehabilitated by who? The governor, you know, His Excellency Mike Sonko. He's a politician, so we have to talk to him nicely. We have to do a lot, you know, convince him that this ground is good, it's historical, and because we have a major tournament here, we have to make the ground. You know, that's how Kenya is. But there are people who have come there with their own agendas. We've had people who gave us really a lot of negative publicity, especially in the run-up to the last general election, which was totally unfair. They came, we welcomed, you know, you come, we welcome you, we tell you, hey, you can sit here. But most of them, they want to sit, you know, in the prominent
VIP zone.
VIP zone. You know, already you're giving them VIP, but there are roles which are specifically for our sponsors. But somebody wants to elbow and bully their way into to that position. Then they go all over the place saying they've sponsored the tournament. And mind you, they have not even given the tournament a single cent. We always have our sponsors whom we mention in everything we do. So we are very, very clear on that. Others come in at the last moment, which is it's an advantage to the winning teams, but it's not at a management level. It's very bad for us, because if you really want to support the tournament, come early. Like right now, we need to pay referees, we need to buy balls, we need to do a lot of things. It's raining, you have to mark the ground after each and every half. So we need them at this particular time to run the tournament. So by the time it's the finals, they've been a part of it. But most of them are just looking like an all. You know, but when the finals reach and they see the crowds and all that, then they come in.
So they're sort of perceptive that probably these are tournament, a platform meant for, you know, making money and reaching the organizers.
Exactly.
And a lot of proceeds come out of it.
And it's not. You know, the number of politicians who come there, they're the ones who, and the, mind you, some of them even have gone on media and say, hey, we sponsored Kotbiro, we gave them $1 million. You tell them, hey, so where is the money? Who did you give the money to? Do you have any paperwork? With us, we have paperwork. Every single cent we receive, we account for it. You receive 10, you give us 5,000, you tell us, what do you want us to do with the 5,000? If you tell us to give it as an award, we'll give it as an award. If you tell us, hey, use 2,000 for administrative purposes and 3,000 for, and we'll do that. And you have to sign the document. We always sign, we always have paperwork to make us accountable, not only within our organization, but also to the key stakeholders, who are the teams. And then remember, the teams are managed and run by guys from the community. So we have to be accountable to everybody at the end of the day. That's why we always challenge anybody, like at any given time, do we owe anyone anything? No. We always pay people, our referees on time, our stewards on time. Whatever is supposed to be given to a team, we usually give them at that particular time that we agreed on. So that's also what makes Kotbiro to be what it is. We are very honest, very frank, and true to the people. But it's the same politicians who fight for the podium, who again at the back give us a bad name.
I remember attending the final last year, and I saw the hustle and bustle at the podium, people trying to fight for, you know,
seats.
VIP seats while I was standing. Of course, I was covering. Anyway, as we come to the almost to the show, to the finale of this particular segment, Coach, I know Football Kenya Federation has had a problem with regards to endorsement and approval of this competition, saying that, you know, sometimes players get subjected to torture when they are participating, and therefore they have to sanction it. What's your comment with regards to that? Do you think it's high time this off-season tournaments? I know it's Christmas festivities, a lot of tournaments, even at the Mashinani, you know, people trying to organize this to give young people a platform to showcase their prowess with this quote of, so that they don't indulge in crime-related activities. From a tactical perspective, what do you think?
Okay, on my end, these tournaments should be going on annually. The FKF should not sanction any tournament, because it is through these tournaments, such tournaments, that we do nurture talents. Because there are so many youths around. All these youths cannot fit in the Premier League teams.
KPL, NSL?
Yeah, NSL, Division 1. So such like tournaments serves a good purpose in nurturing the boys. So I support the tournaments should be going on, and FKF should support such like tournaments.
Your team Peliko FC, expectations? What are we looking forward to? Are you winning the league? You are on national television.
Yeah, we are winning.
You are winning?
Yeah.
How did you fare last season during the previous edition?
Kotbiro?
Yes.
The last edition, we didn't reach the last 16. the round of 16. But this year, I can assure you that we'll reach somewhere.
I'm going to be keeping tabs on the same and see how we pan out.
Okay.
But Hassan, Experience FC, what are you telling your teammates, your technical bench members, and even the fans outside there?
You know, our team, I think it's the best team.
It's the best team right now as you speak.
Currently.
And you have much confidence in it.
Pelico.
After Pelico. So to some extent, you've already thrown in the towel.
Maybe we'll play Pelico in the final. If it's not the final, semi-final.
Let's see how that develops. Roba, your parting shot?
Yeah, I just want to talk about, you know, FKF has been very, very supportive.
Yes.
Nick Mwendwa, he was there the finals last season.
Yes.
And we're also expecting him to be at this season's final grand finale. He's been very supportive. He talks to our committee members. And in fact, we want even more support from them because they know what Coach Biro does. You know, the richness, the history. 40 years, man, 40 years. Before I was even born, it has been in existence. So we're just saying that at some point the tournaments become too many and they need to sieve. They need to know which ones have specific objectives. But let's remember that there are tournaments that are specifically for football and bringing the communities together. And then there are the other tournaments where somebody just starts a tournament to make money.
For the sake of self-gains.
Somebody starts a tournament because they are vying for a political seat. And then we've also seen so many tournaments run by CDFs, by MPs, which are not football specific. They're just there for other issues. But
so the essence and significance has to be for development. Football.
Yes.
And not for self-gains, not for as a stepping stone, a ladder to politics.
True. And that's what Coach Biro is all about. And that's why we work in close partnership with the FKF. In fact, this season, we were not to play Coach Biro. But because it was our 40th anniversary, we decided, hey, let's finish off in style. Because KPL, the league season is also changing. From next year, Coach Biro will have to change. To be played in June, July. So, you know, our love with FKF is there, and in fact, we are working on a document, and we are going to ask the FKF president, Mr. Nick Mwendwa, to be our patron.
Thanks, man, for coming through. Robert Ojola, CEO, Coach Biro, alongside Hassan Abdil, Player Experience FC is saying that they have got confidence they can win or probably finish runners-up as far as this edition is concerned. And Coach Frederick Okoth, Pelico FC tactician, is saying that despite the fact that they didn't perform well last season, this time round they're going to defy all odds. Thanks, gentlemen, for coming through. We're going to be keeping tabs on the tournament and see how it progresses. That has been review of 2018 Coach Biro tournament happening on Y254 this particular afternoon. The Touchline, the show. My name is Maxwell Wasiku. We're going to take a short break and see what transpired as far as midweek pulsating clash beating Arsenal against Man United. Both are struggling teams. Not like my Nottingham Forest, though. Two-time UEFA Champions League winner. Of course, the fan favorite segment, the fan zone, coming up next. Webster Mwangi, a diehard Arsenal supporter. You see that guy screaming whenever Arsenal scores. What? Nyambura Mridhi, an Arsenal supporter as well, and Joe Saina, the dreaded Man United fan, will be joining me shortly on the set to discuss about what has been trending as far as international football is concerned. Ballon d'Or awards, Mark Hughes sacking at a Southampton tactician, and the preview of Chelsea-Manchester clash happening this evening at 8:30 p.m. Don't go away. Stay tuned. This is The Touchline.